These biblical leadership traits will cause your family, your business, the people that follow you, either to thrive or to survive. What are they? We'll cover that in this episode of the Seven Figure Scripture Series, starting in 3, 2, 1. Let's go.
Never short stopping, now I'm winning like I'm Jeter. Steady through the rigor, yeah, I'm getting bigger. In them trenches, now I'm making seven figures like.
What's crack-a-lacking, everybody? Money Smart Guy Matt Sapaula here, hailing to you from the Money Smart headquarters here of the Seven Figure Squad studio in Oak Brook Terrace, Illinois. And we just got back from a week-long training event in Dallas, Texas. And I'll tell you this, we had one big main training topic of increasing people's skill set. But even through all that, unless people adopted these five traits, they will either thrive or survive or make the most of the training, or it will just flop a week later, a month later, a year later. What are they? Well, I want to cover Proverbs chapter 29 of the Bible, written by King Solomon, who is regarded as the richest king who ever lived. Because here's the thing. People will reflect their leader. You know, when you're looking at the country as a whole, didn't the people reflect President Trump differently? I mean, look at now. Don't people reflect the country differently now with President Biden? Look at teams and coaches. Don't the players reflect their coaches? Don't people reflect their families? But here's the challenge. People cannot get further beyond the reflection of their leader. You know, we're training in Dallas. We're teaching our sales guys from coast to coast. Over 2,500 agents were in attendance. And I was having a personal conversation, a personal training topic on being the difference between being a salesperson and being a sales leader. Who thrives and who survives? Well, here are five traits. Let's take a look at it. Let's unpack it here. In Proverbs chapter 9, verse 2, it reads like this. When the righteous are in authority, the people rejoice. But when a wicked man rules, the people groan. You know, I can't tell you how many times we've all watched either cartoons or movies of the medieval times and how that country or how that cartoon or that story unfolded, whether there was a wicked leader at the top, a happy family with happy children, with a happy tribe, a happy household, or a wicked king that had wicked lords, that had wicked people in the countryside ruling that land. And when we're looking at the first attribute, when we're talking about the righteous people having people rejoice, is because they have the right attitude. We often say in sales that attitude is a reflection of your altitude. So if you've got a great attitude, which is sadly one of the things that we cannot help people with, as much training, as much influence, as much coaching and guidance, you know, the sad part about it, we cannot help people if they have a bad attitude. That has to come from you. It has to come from inside. It has to come from somebody say, you know what? I want to change. I want to be better. I realize that what I'm doing is more than just for myself. It is for my family. It is for my legacy. It is for my company. We often say your attitude is what inspires your people, or sadly, is what repels your people. So if you want to lead people, you want to become a first generation cash flow millionaire, well, guess what? You better have the right attitude. Number two is stability. Let's look at Proverbs chapter 9, verse 4. It reads like this. The king establishes the land by justice, but he who receives bribes overthrows it. And I'm reading this out of the Maxwell Leadership Bible, which is a Bible that many of you should pick up if you want to lead with biblical principles and traits. And John Maxwell actually unpacks it here. He says, when moral leaders rule, they establish justice. Compromising leaders will tear things down. And when we're looking at people that have stability in their life, you know, have you ever wondered why the United States of America in the last, 100 plus years has not voted in a single president who's not married? And think about it. Many of the churches, many people that lead businesses, many people that lead governments, that lead people, they're looking for what? Without them even knowing it, they're looking for stability. You know, how many times have we seen unstable families? Maybe you've been part of an unstable family. I was part of an unstable family. I was a single parent at one point in my life. For 14 years, I was raising my kids by myself as a single dad with three kids. And I'm telling you this, from personal experience, there's lots of instability in my life. And once I recognized Scripture was leading me a certain way, I need to establish structure, because establishing structure created stability. I mean, look what's going on in the world today. When's the last time you worried that people were launching rockets into the United States borders? When's the last time you worried about that? Why? Because the United States of America, for whatever you feel about this great country, has created stability. We don't worry about these things. I pray for all my friends out there in the Middle East, between this war between Israel and the Palestinians fighting with one another. Why? Because of lack of stability. There is instability. And when people are unstable, people can't thrive. Economies can't thrive. Buildings can't be built. I mean, how many buildings have we seen over in the Middle East? When I was over there in the Middle East, when I was there in Somalia, Africa, as a United States Marine, you know what I saw a lot of? I saw a lot of instability. The craziest thing, people just walking around, haven't eaten well in years, babies walking around with bellies out here. Why? Because in that country, there is instability. And aren't we glad we're being raised, or for those of you watching this, in America, you are blessed to be in America. Why? Because we have a very stable country. As much as you feel indifferent about the United States of America from where it is today, you may not agree with a lot of things, but you know what we have a lot of in this country? We have a lot of checks and balances. We have a lot of stability. What happens to a family? Listen, my wife and I are in our fifth kid. Three, I had. One, she had. Blended family of four. One, when we got married, we created together, Jordan. But I'm telling you this, from my wife and I learning from our own experiences of being single parents on our own, being unstable with our finances, unstable with our emotions, unstable with our spiritual life, unstable with our personal life. Once we got married, once we established that our relationship will be founded upon biblical principles and truths, when Jordan was born, and now he's part of this household, and there is not only emotional stability, spiritual stability, and thank God, financial stability, it's a much different dynamic for this kid, being the youngest of the five, to be raised in this dynamic. The other four, sadly, did not experience. They're experiencing it now, but then experiencing it at when they were 1 year old or 2 years old, the same age that Jordan is around. But stability is so important. If you want to become a first-generation cash flow millionaire, guess what you have to have? You must have stability in your emotions, your finances. You're emotionally stable, you're spiritually stable, you're financially stable, and guess what? You inspire other people to also thrive. Number three is compassion. Really? Compassion? Let's look at this. At Proverbs chapter 9, verse 7, it reads like this. The righteous considers the cause of the poor, but the wicked does not understand such knowledge. Again, John Maxwell breaks it down in this leadership Bible. He says like this. Good leaders express concern for the poor, but bad leaders reflect no compassion for anyone. Listen, I know what this country is going through. A lot of different injustices are going on right now. Social injustice, financial injustice. You know, injustice is because businesses are locked down because of the pandemic. People are feeling injustice because they're feeling they're being forced to take this vaccine. Well, listen, if you lack compassion for what people are going through and you're always judging people, you're coming from a high horse, you're coming from a high throne, nobody's going to listen to you. And people will feel like this. People will feel guarded up with you all the time. But I feel in my own personal dealings, in spite of the success that my wife and I had, many successes, there are business partners that had, especially coming through this pandemic. You know what I see them doing? I see them giving. I see them lending a helping hand. I see them sitting down with people who have less. I see them teaching people who have been left without. I see them helping others who are unaware. Why? Because they come from this position called compassion. So if you want to become a first generation cash flow millionaire and stay there, and you want your team and family and company, your congregation to thrive, well, guess what? You must have compassion. Okay, number four is honesty. Yes, honesty. Let's read about that in Proverbs chapter 29, verse 12. It reads like this. If a ruler pays attention to lies, all his servants become wicked. Again, John Maxwell breaks this down here. When leaders pay attention to lies, their staff begins to esteem the same deceptions. You know, oftentimes that I've seen myself in the financial services industry. And because we deal with money, because we deal with an area of greed, we deal with an area of selfishness, we deal with an area of covetousness, this is the area that the devil loves to hang out and keep people down. And oftentimes you said, you know what, guys, listen, there is no cutting corners here in financial services. There is not cutting corners to make sure we do what's best for the customer, to do what's best for the client. Actually, inside the insurance industry, inside the financial services industry, we have this fancy term called fiduciary. which means always putting the interests of the client before you. Honestly, even in spite, if you don't make any money at this thing, as much commission as you'd like to make, but if you put the interests of the client ahead all the time in front of your own self-interest, guess what? You're working in a position of honesty. When you work in a position of honesty, you work in an area of compassion, of clarity, and guess what? You fall asleep at night and your pillow is soft. You're operating your life, you're operating your business, you're operating your finances without having gold dueling like this, looking over your back. So if you want to become a first generation cash flow millionaire and you want to adopt a trait from the Bible that every millionaire needs, well, guess what? It goes without saying, it is honesty. Trait number five, last but definitely not least, vision. Let's look at that. Proverbs chapter 9, verse 18. It reads like this. When there is no revelation, the people cast off restraint. But happy is he who keeps the law. I like reading another translation. It reads like this too as well. When there is no vision, the people perish. But he that keepeth the law, happy is he. Again, John Maxwell breaks it down here in the Maxwell Leadership Bible. He breaks it like this. Solid vision keeps everyone on track. Chaos reigns whenever the vision lapses. Now, we spent a lot of time in Dallas resetting ourselves on vision. There's a lot of big things that our company is on track to doing in the next 10 years. And I remember my mentor, Patrick Bendib, he says something like this before. It says, a visionary talks about a future truth, which makes him a present liar. But with that being said, for those in that following, for those in that family, for those in that company, for those in that team, for those in that church, for those in that ministry, for those in the city, if there is, for those in that country for that matter, if there is vision, then people buy in to that vision, especially if this visionary has a track record of saying things and coming through. So when I ask you this question, when you have self-evaluate watching this video, do I cast a vision to my family? Do I cast a vision what type of values and principles of which we stand upon? Do I cast a vision where my family is going to end up, where my children, that identity, are you shaping and molding the identity of those you love and care about? Are you shaping the identity of your children to say, you know, you can do some great things. You can do some great things. Because you know why? Because once they get into the world and they get beat up, guess what they stop doing? They stop dreaming, just like many of you that's watching this video. Many of you have turned off the dream machine. You know why? Because you forgot about your vision. And when you forget about your vision, you forget about where you can go, you start worrying about bills. You start worrying about all these things. Of course, those matter. Those responsibilities matter. Your obligations matter. But when you focus your head down versus, man, I can accomplish this, I can accomplish that. This is why we're working this hard. This is why we do these daggone crazy closeouts. This is why we compete so hard. That's why we compete with empathy and excitement and the right attitude and the right type of stability, because there's a vision of where we're headed and where we're going. But if there's no vision, well, what's it all for? And then once you reach that goal and there's no vision after that, there's no next one, two, three, four, five moves, then what's next? What happens when a leader doesn't have its next? You know what happens? Here's what happens. They get bored. And guess what happens? That leader who's bored, they don't realize it, that they're operating bored. But the people realize it, that leader is bored. It goes without saying. Why? Because they end up doing some ridiculous things. They get caught up in getting caught up, doing some foolishness, doing some things that don't lead towards that vision. Because if you're clear about where you're going, then every decision leading up to that point, guess what starts happening? It makes that step much more clear. And it makes the reaching of the next milestone that much more exciting. Because when there's vision, people are excited. But when there's no vision, sadly, people perish. They just look to survive instead of them thriving. Crazy part is that vision is something that a lot of people lost either the excitement or the muscle to build. And that vision is something that a lot of people have not seen themselves doing for a very long time. Sometimes we talk about this childlike enthusiasm, this childlike inside. I didn't say it's childish, but this childlike enthusiasm that creates energy, because we have a saying around here that energy is money. If you're boring, guess what happens? You have boring money. But if you're excited, you have the right attitude, the right vision, you're pumped up, you jump out of bed every morning because of your vision, not just because you're paying the bills, but because you have vision. And when you have vision and people are excited, other people, they too also feel that from you. So as I wrap up, I'm wondering, what are your thoughts on these biblical traits that every millionaire needs? Are you exemplifying them? Are these things that you have to work on? In the comment section below, say, I need to work on blank. I need to work on blank. In these series on the Seven Figure Squad YouTube channel is to help you get closer, an inch further, closer, and get more clarity. So therefore, you can become a first generation cash flow millionaire and stay there. It's one thing to be a millionaire once. It's another thing to sustain this over the test of time. Just keep this in mind. Bottom line, your team, your company, your family, your organization will always reflect you because you are the leader. If you want to lead and you want to come, and by the way, you just don't have a such thing as a passive millionaire. Oh, it just landed on your lap. No, people have to work towards getting there. Now, sustaining that and evolving that and getting to the next level, well, that will cause you to incorporate these five biblical traits to make sure you not only get there, but you stay there. So, with that being said, let me know your thoughts, your comments, your follow-ups, your feedback. Drop them in the comment section below. Please share this with somebody that you feel is going to become a first-generation cash flow millionaire. And I hope that you're inspired to say, you know what? I'm going to look at myself in the mirror. I'm going to look at my traits of these things that I'm going to improve on a scale of 1 to 10. I need to get myself closer to the 10 mark versus the 1 mark. Put this down on a piece of paper. Put it in the mirror and remind yourselves of these leadership traits. But before I let you go, there's a couple of videos I'd love for you to check out. Number one, check out this video right here, How Millionaires Manifest Money. And the second video here I would love for you to check out is How Millionaires Make Their Dreams Come True. That being said, guys, if you're watching this on Facebook, make sure you click like and follow our business page, Money Smart Guy. And if you're watching this on YouTube, make sure you click subscribe and hit notifications to be alerted the next time we upload our next episode. That being said, guys, I'm your Money Smart Guy. And until we meet again, continue to live smart, continue to love smart, and be money smart today. God bless you guys.